You only have a couple of minutes left to vote in the ASG election. Thanks for watching Bobcat Update. I'm Anna Anguiano.
And I'm Danielle Elizabeth Mattson. We'll also tell you why some students are having a hard time finding an apartment. The Associated Student Government elections are underway. Voting started yesterday at 8 a.m. and will end tonight at 5 p.m. To vote, all you need to do is head by the Texas State University webpage and click on the voting link at the bottom of the page. Polling stations are located in the LBJ Mall area and also on the third floor of the LBJ Student Center. Results from the election will be announced tonight at 6 p.m.
Enrollment at Texas State University continues to rise, but there aren't enough on-campus locations to house everyone. As Lynn McCann tells us in this Bobcat update, finding shelter on or off campus is challenging in San Marcos.
Those students who can't live on campus look for places to live in apartments, lofts, townhomes, or duplexes. And even then, they have to be lucky.
Many students have had the idea of renting a house together and splitting the rent and bills between 3, 4, or even 5 people in a house like this one. But according to the city of San Marcos, this is illegal. And if a student is caught, not only would they be evicted immediately, they could be fined.
Basically, you can have 2 different last names in a house, and if you have a 3rd last name, that violates the zoning restrictions in most of San Marcos.
Students should start visiting home locators as early as 9 or 10 months in advance to assure themselves that they will have a place to live. But houses are rented about 1 month in advance, which makes finding one at the right time even harder.
I think everybody would love a house. You have your own backyard, you can bring in your own grill, that's your property if you're renting it, that's your space, you know.
The zoning laws are designed to establish uniformity and stability throughout the city. Consequences of a zoning violation can result in a fine of up to $2,000 per day per violation. For Bobcat Update, I'm Lynn McCann.
Students are joining the effort to help the survivors in Japan. The Japanese Language and Culture Club raised money in the quad today for Japan's disaster relief. The recent earthquake and tsunami left over 15,000 people missing. People who donate $10 or more will get a free t-shirt showing their support. All the proceeds will go to the Japanese Red Cross. The club will be at the LBJ Student Center tomorrow from 10 to 3 to accept more donations.
Thornton International House is the new headquarters at Texas State for university programs related to international relations. The move to consolidate includes the intensive language program, the international office, and the study abroad office. More than 340 students are signed up for faculty-led study abroad programs this summer. All trips to Mexico, though, have been canceled. Trips to Japan are pending while the university waits for new information from the U.S. Department of State.
The Center for the Study of Latino Media and Markets at Texas State will present the 2nd International Documentary Festival, Puntos de Vista 2011, tomorrow in the LBJ Student Center. Puntos de Vista, or Points of View in English, invites film and communication students from Latin America, Spain, and the Caribbean to submit documentaries about environmental, religious, and social issues. There are 15 entries for the festival, and 6 will be selected and shown. 3 awards ranging from $2,000 to $500 will also be presented.
On a campus as diverse as Texas State's, it's important to remember the leaders who helped create a climate that allowed people of such mixed backgrounds to come together and form a community of education. Douglas Bloom has more.
The Latino Student Association held its annual Cesar Chavez celebration yesterday, honoring the civil rights activist with dinner and a movie. One goal of the event was to promote diversity and to highlight Chavez's achievements. A brief biography of the icon and his accomplishments was followed by a catered buffet and a screening of a documentary titled The Longoria Affair. The award-winning documentary tells the story of a family who is not allowed to use the town's only funeral parlor to bury their son, a Latino soldier killed during World War II. The refusal caused a national outrage. Texas State senior Nathan Salazar says it's important to honor Chavez.
He represents a legacy for not just Hispanics or immigrants or farm workers, but for humanity in general.
The Cesar Chavez celebration is the largest event held each year by the Latino Student Association.
Yeah, I believe that if it weren't for this event, some people probably would never know who Cesar Chavez was or what he did. So through this event, we offer a little bit of education behind him, as well as show things that he's done for our community.
With food and festivities, the Latino Student Association brought together a multicultural campus in celebration of an American hero. Cesar Chavez led a historic civil rights movement for the working class that is still an inspiration today. For Bobcat Update, I'm Douglas Bloom.
Teen pregnancies in the U.S. are at a record low. That's according to new statistics from the Centers for Disease Control. In 2009, around 410,000 teenage girls ages 15 to 19 gave birth. That's a 37% decrease from the teen birth rate nearly 20 years earlier. In other words, in 1991, about 60 births per every 1,000 females was a teen pregnancy. Now it's down about 40 teen births per 1,000 women. But according to United Nations, the rate of teen pregnancy in the U.S. is still nearly 9 times higher than in the majority of other developed nations.
A San Marcos woman who used her footwear as a weapon is going away for a long time.
That story is coming up next on Bobcat Update.
Stoppers is a nonprofit organization aimed to stop crime. Tipsters provide their knowledge and information of a crime, which helps law enforcement agencies in their investigations. They offer anonymity to people who provide information about crimes and pay up to $1,000 in rewards when information leads to an arrest. So make your community safer and don't be afraid to get involved. If you see any type of crime, call 512-245-STOP.
New research in the Journal of Neuroscience shows meditation can be even more effective at relieving pain than prescription painkillers. The study tested the response to pain in 15 test subjects. They were mildly burned on their legs and were asked to rate the pain. After 4 20-minute meditation training classes, the subjects said the pain they felt decreased by as much as 40%. Brain scans conducted during the experiments show that meditation can actually change how the mind perceives and responds to pain.
The battle against cancer is being fought right here at Texas State. More than $24,000 was raised over the weekend to go toward cancer research. The annual Relay for Life was held at Bobcat Stadium, and those who participated walked, ran, and even danced around the track to help raise donations for the cause. Some of the participants were cancer survivors, and others were there to remember lost loved ones. The money raised will be given to the American Cancer Society.
A woman from San Marcos is headed to prison for 10 years for beating her 4-year-old son with a sandal. According to San Marcos local news, that was the maximum punishment Rebecca Hewitt could have received. She was also fined $5,000. Hewitt's lawyers argued for a lesser punishment, saying the woman simply overstepped her boundaries in spanking her child. Hewitt's little boy is now 7 and lives out of state.
The Confederate flag sparks racial tension in the Texas town of Palestine in Anderson County. Last week, county officials voted to allow the Sons of Confederate Veterans to fly the Stars and Bars flag below the American and Texas flags on the courthouse lawn. But many people voiced their disapproval, including the head of the NAACP. County Commissioner Rashad Mims, who voted against raising the flag in the first place, says he's thankful the matter was resolved peacefully.
A brush fire that began along the Mexican border reached Texas at a small town near Nuevo Laredo. Several homes were destroyed and dozens of people evacuated parts of the town. The wildfire started Monday afternoon on the Mexican side of the Rio Grande. Wind caused it to quickly spread over into Texas. The fire is now under control. The Laredo Morning Times reports that 40 people were left homeless and about 2,000 acres were blackened on both sides of the border.
Is there a chance we could be seeing some rain here in San Marcos?
Well, I sure hope so. We'll have the forecast next on Bobcat Update.
Thank you.
This is Louise Armstrong with your weather report. It's currently 77 degrees here in San Marcos. It's sunny and it's a little windy, but it looks like that's going to clear up as we move into the weekend. We're going to take a look at temperatures in Texas. Today it was 80 degrees in El Paso, 81 in Brownsville, which is not surprising as it's usually warmer there. In Central Texas, 73 degrees in Austin, 72 in Houston, and in Amarillo up in the Panhandle. The coldest temperatures in Texas were in Dallas. We're going to look at the national temperatures now. If you're looking for some colder weather, the best bet is the northwest corner of the United States. It's in the mid-40s there. However, the coldest part of the U.S. today was Denver, Colorado, 39 degrees. In both coasts, it was in the mid-50s, 53 in New York and 54 in San Francisco. The Midwest was seeing temperatures in the mid-70s, the hottest part of the U.S. today. Florida, temperatures at 79, didn't quite hit that 80 mark, but it looks like it will be moving there. We're going to look at the weather conditions now. It was rainy in the northwest corner of the United States, rainy up in Seattle and in Denver, Colorado. I'm sure that wasn't great mixed with those cold temperatures. The Midwest was mostly sunny after a lot of rain, torrential floods, and wind in that region this week. It's sunny now, but meteorologists are saying that wind could be moving from the Midwest to the southeast corner of the United States. New York had a little bit of both, sunny and a little bit of partly cloudy. As we move into the weekend, it's going to be a low of 65 tonight. It's going to be about in the mid-80s tomorrow. And as we head into the weekend, 92 degrees and sunny for that weekend.
Well, Louise, it looks like it's going to be a pretty good weekend.
It is. Do you guys have any plans to enjoy this lovely warm weather?
Well, I want to go to Sewell Park. It's time to get out that bikini.
You know, I really wish I could say I could go out too, but got a test coming up and I have to study.
Work on Bobcat Stadium is moving right along. We'll show you what's being done next in sports.
There are nearly 100 state parks in Texas, with over 20 in the Hill Country area alone. The Texas Park System is celebrating its 87th birthday this year with over $40 million in upgrades and restorations. These park improvements include trail maintenance, expanded campsite capabilities, as well as major cabin restorations and the creation of new learning centers and museums. Texas state parks are a great way to enjoy nature, whether you're looking to relax or for a full slate of activities. Texas state parks offer hiking, biking, camping, fishing, boating, golf, and more. So come out and take pride in the natural beauty of Texas. For more information, contact the Texas State Parks and Wildlife Department at tpwd.state.tx.us.
Hi, I'm Erica Everett with sports. The women's basketball team at Texas A&M can now claim the trophy. In the Aggies' first trip to the NCAA Women's Final Four, they won the championship by holding off Notre Dame with a 76-70 victory last night. The Aggies were led by senior Danielle Adams, who scored 22 of her 30 points in the second half. It was the first matchup of number 2 seeds in the history of the tournament. A&M became the first team to win the title on its initial try since fellow Big 12 conference member Baylor did it in 2005. The UConn men's team won its third NCAA championship Monday night with a 53-41 victory over the Butler Bulldogs. The Bulldogs were held to a mere 18.8 field goal percentage for the game, a record low for a title game. There was plenty not to love about the game. UConn's 53 points were the lowest by a winning team since Kentucky beat Oklahoma 46-36 in 1949. Butler led 22-19 at the half. It was the lowest combined first half score in a title game since 1946. Connecticut has now won the men's championship 3 times. Ace left-hander C.J. Wilson led the Texas Rangers to a 6-0 record and a series sweep this afternoon as they defeated Cy Young winner Felix Hernandez and the Seattle Mariners 7-3. Wilson's last start was on opening night in which he went 5 2/3 innings, allowing 4 runs on 6 hits. Mike Leake threw 6 solid innings, and Chris Heisey drove in 3 as the Cincinnati Reds remained unbeaten with an 8-2 win over the Houston Astros in the opener of a 3-game series. Leake limited Houston to 2 runs on 3 hits and 2 walks. He also struck out 4 for Cincinnati, who are 4-0 for the first time since 1990 when the Reds won the World Series. They took advantage of Astros pitcher J.A. Happ, who lasted only 4 innings, giving up 7 hits and 7 runs. He struggled with control, throwing only 52 of his 91 pitches for strikes, walking 5, and hitting a batter. The Texas State baseball team is on the road to take on the 18th-ranked Arkansas team tonight. Junior right-hander Mitchell Pitts will make his 8th start for Texas State. Pitts has a 3-0 record and 33 strikeouts. He will be up against another right-hander, Ryan Stanek, who is 1-0 in 5 starts. The 19-8 Bobcats are coming off a series win against Stephen F. Austin to capture first place in the Southland Conference, while the Razorbacks have dropped 4 of their last 5 games. Bobcat Stadium has already had several renovations in recent years, but more changes are on the way. The renovations have included an end zone complex and luxury suites, but starting this summer, additional seats will be added, which will bring the capacity to about 30,000 fans. The new area will include a gallery dedicated to the Texas State Strutters and an extension of the bookstore fan shop. The renovations are deemed necessary for the football program moving to the Western Athletic Conference, and construction will begin in May, but preparations are already underway. With the change in the weather, the Texas State Golf Course is encouraging students to get out and play. Sam Howell has more in this Bobcat Update.
The Masters Golf Tournament begins tomorrow, and students who enjoy golf are being offered incentives to play at the Texas State Golf Course.
Every Wednesday, student green fees are 2-for-1, so they're $3.50 for a student green fee. Every other day of the week, it's $7, and weekends is $10 for students, so it's always inexpensive.
On Sunday, the greens at the course were aerated, and on Monday and Tuesday, golfers could play at a discounted price of $3.50.
I just want the student body to know that we're here for them and encouraging them to come out and play.
Last Friday, the course had a one-club golf tournament to add some competitive excitement. The winner shot a 76 using an 8-iron. Walk-ins are welcome, or to reserve a tee time, you can call 512-245-7593. For Bobcat Update, I'm Sam Howell.
Commissioner Roger Goodell and other NFL executives will be closely watching developments in a Minnesota courtroom today. A federal judge will hear arguments from lawyers representing NFL players who want an immediate end to the ongoing lockout. Last month, league owners imposed the lockout after failing to reach a deal with players over revenue sharing. Football stars Tom Brady, Drew Brees, Peyton Manning, and 7 other players filed a lawsuit on behalf of other players to legally force an end to the lockout. If an agreement isn't reached soon, the 2011 NFL season could be delayed or canceled. There's a strange-looking shoe gaining popularity among students at Texas State. Valerie Soya has more in this Bobcat Update.
These gloves for your feet are called Vibram Five Fingers. They're designed to simulate the experience of being barefoot while still offering some protection from the elements.
Freshman Mitchell Ryder says the shoes make him feel lighter on his feet.
They're really comfortable for walking. It's kind of like walking barefoot, just having like calluses on your feet so you don't feel anything. Like you feel the texture of the ground, but it doesn't hurt at all whenever you're walking on rocks or anything.
Some experts say that traditional athletic shoes with their structured sides and cushioned heels keep your feet restricted, making them lazy, weak, and more prone to injury. As a result, the barefoot craze is gaining attention from coaches, personal trainers, and runners. Personal trainer Jen Martinez says that she has felt the health benefits from running with her Vibram.
A lot of people say, well, they look goofy and that there's some science against them. And I say, I don't care about what any other science says. There's some that shows that it works and some that shows that it doesn't. But for me, it works. My knee stopped hurting, my hip stops hurting, and that's what matters.
Runner Kyle Graff says that although he has had a pair for a year, the shoes are not for him.
For me, they didn't really fit right because like one of my feet are longer than the other. And if you go more than like 4 miles, you might get like blisters.
If barefoot shoes are for you, Vibrams cost between $75 and $100 and can be found online or at stores across the country. For Bobcat Update, I'm Valerie Soya.
Those are some interesting shoes. How do y'all feel about those?
I know, those look pretty funny.
I think I'll stick to my heels.
That's all for this edition of Bobcat Update. Thanks for watching.
We'll be right back tomorrow afternoon at 4:30. See you then.